Started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here.
And that's exactly where England's going to start, at the bottom, because in the early period of their attempts at colonization of North America, before the first successful colony at Jamestown, they are going to struggle, to say the least. Now, quick little review here. Why are countries such as England and Spain and France and Holland exploring and eventually colonizing these different parts of the globe? And the motives are pretty much the same regardless of which country you're looking at. They're looking for the three G's. Glory, you want this political power, you know, becoming a wealthy nation and having land and resources. This translates into political influence and the glory. You also have economic, this kind of gold. And it doesn't have to be gold. It could be silver, it could be beaver fur, it could be tobacco, it could be rice, it could be whatever. But these nations are looking for new trade routes to places such as Asia, or just striking it rich like the Spanish did when they conquered parts of Latin America. And of course, the third one, the third G, is God. They want to spread Christianity, whether it be Catholicism or Protestant, different Protestant groups coming to the New World for all their different motives. Keep in mind, these three motives reinforce. They're not independent of one another very often. So these are the three G's. Now, this story of English colonization really kind of begins with the so-called Virgin Queen.
It all makes sense. You're a virgin.
Queen Elizabeth. And she gets that kind of nickname because she never married. And a little backdrop here for a moment. 1530, if you remember, Henry VIII broke with the Catholic Church and he launches this Protestant Reformation. And in 1558, Henry's daughter, the Protestant Elizabeth, the woman you see right here, she becomes queen. Protestantism is firmly established in England, and she is going to pursue a very aggressive policy of expansion of England. And she is a Protestant. It's the dominant religion in the country by this point, and she's going to be looking to expand England's wealth and power. You could see that in this political cartoon where she has her hand on the globe and an event is being depicted in the backdrop, which we'll take a look at in just a moment. Now, even before Queen Elizabeth takes over, there were British explorers coming into this North American land. You got an Italian guy by the name of John Cabot in 1497. He's cruising over, hired by England, and he comes over along the coast over here. He looks around Newfoundland in what today will be Canada, and they're looking up opportunities. They're opening up opportunities. They don't really establish any settlement. There was an attempt in 1583 to establish a colony at Newfoundland over in this region right here once again, but it ultimately fails. Now, what England was doing in this early period is they weren't really establishing colonies, but they had these guys named sea dogs, and the most famous one is a guy by the name of Drake.
This girl said my name, wear it out, it's getting hot.
Sir Francis Drake, the original Drake, and he really is kind of putting it out there for England by attacking Spanish treasure fleets, Spanish ships that are leaving their colonies. Remember, Spain's colonies were quite vast, and as Spain is leaving places like the Caribbean or Mexico or modern-day Peru, they have all this loot, and people like Francis Drake are trying to steal it or sack Spanish settlements in the New World. Now, obviously, if you're Spain, you don't like this, but Spain's going to have a difficult time managing this huge empire. 1577, Francis Drake is sailing all over the world, in fact, gets over into San Francisco Bay, even. So you have this early attempts, and then the Newfoundland idea fails, but then you get the guy named Sir Walter Raleigh. Who's looking to strike it rich, and he gets a charter from the Queen of England, the so-called Virgin Queen. He names the area all in her honor, Virginia, And Sir Walter Raleigh gets this charter, gets this agreement from Queen Elizabeth, and he sets out an expedition. Doesn't go, sends other people along the way in 1585, and they establish the colony of Roanoke. Now, you can see where Jamestown's going to be in 1607, so Roanoke, right off the coast of what is today North Carolina. Now, the colony is established in 1585, and I know you're thinking, okay, this is it, we're going to make this happen, but they're going to struggle. There's going to be some guys that leave, and then more people are going to come over, and, you know, under this plan, under Walter Raleigh's, you know, leadership and his planning, you get this colony of around 114 men, women, and children who are there, and it's one of the first attempts by England to colonize North America. They're supposed to come back a year later, and it takes them 3 years, and when they finally go back to offer the supplies, oh no. No trace of the colony. When they finally go back in 1590, there's no evidence at all of the colony except for some words written on a tree. C-R-O. And we don't really know what happened, but that name, that term, was the name of a Native American tribe in the region. And when this expedition returns to offer them some supplies, the colony has disappeared. And we don't really know to this day. Historians disagree. There's some evidence that possibly the people, the so-called lost colony of Roanoke, they perhaps went and joined Native Americans because life got too rough and they kind of, you know, put themselves into the tribe. Other theories that Native Americans wiped them out, or a Spanish fleet wiped them out, or they just, you know, said, screw it, no one's coming to get us, let's go home, and then they sunk. We don't know. But what we do know is this colony is now, Roanoke is the lost colony. And more importantly, what does this mean? The importance of it. It's lost. But it really proves that colonization is going to be risky. It's going to be difficult. It's going to cost a lot of money. And the North American environment is wild and untamed and unknown. And this is going to show, especially the monarch, that if you're going to have a future colonial expedition, it's going to have to be self-financing. The king's not going to, you know, pay the tab. So that's going to be the importance of joint stock companies, which will be formed and eventually be what pays for the colony of Jamestown. Now, this is a big disappointment for England because if you recall, make sure you watch the Spanish lecture, there was prosperity that Spain was achieving in their colonization of the Western Hemisphere. They had this empire that was huge. But that's going to be a problem because it's going to be difficult to manage. And to complicate things, luck turns in favor of England when you look at what happens in 1588. Prior to 1588, the most powerful navy in the world was Spain. In fact, the Spanish Armada was famous. It was like this invincible fleet. And if you think about it, having a powerful navy is so essential because how are you going to send these expeditions, resupply the colonies, get the raw materials back into your mother country of Spain? The navy's going to play this role. And the Spanish Armada had almost complete control over the seas, which makes it harder for other countries to try to colonize, including England. Well, in 1588, King Philip II decides that he is going to invade England. He does not like Protestant Queen Elizabeth. He doesn't like the rise of Protestantism in England. And he decides that he's going to go in there with his big, powerful navy, 130 ships, they're rolling deep, and he's going to lay out a can of whoop-ass. And here's what happens.
Thug life.
The famous Spanish Armada is defeated. In fact, there's a whole bunch of reasons why it's defeated, but here you see the Spanish Armada being defeated, and this is a game changer, because now England can plant colonies, supply the colonies, and protect the colonies, because from this point forward, England is going to have naval dominance in the Atlantic Ocean and eventually all the oceans. And so you have this sense of pride in England, this sense of nationalism. And so 1588, Roanoke has already failed at that point, but England, on the eve of emerging as an empire, has a whole bunch of things happening. You know, for one, there was this huge population expansion, and there's a lack of economic opportunity. There was this enclosure movement where land was being closed off for the grazing of sheep, and farmers are getting kicked off the land and they're moving to the city, so unemployment is going up and things aren't going well because for a lot of people there's a lack of opportunity. This is going to be a motive for expansion. You also have the laws of primogeniture, which basically meant if you were the oldest son, you got all the land, and if you were the second, third, fourth son, and you were ambitious, you were left out of this opportunity. So you got all these ambitious young men like Francis Drake, Walter Raleigh, who are looking for opportunities to make a name for themselves and to collect wealth. Then in 1604... England and Spain sign a treaty which is going to stabilize the relationship between these two countries, and then you got all those religious motives that play a role in colonization. Now, super important, in the beginning, England is having difficulties, they're failing, but eventually they are going to become successful with Jamestown in 1607. It's the first, but there will be others. And something extremely important, especially those of you who are studying for APUSH, unlike the other countries, especially Spain and France and the Dutch in North America, England's going to send a huge number of people over to this North American colony, and you're going to see what happens in the other lectures. So that's going to do it for today.
I started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team.
Started from the bottom, but eventually England will dominate North America. Those are the terms that you probably need to know if you're taking an AP or US history class. Thank you for checking out the video. Make sure you subscribe to Jost Productions, and have a beautiful night. Peace.